the Lord has made. Whoa, I will rejoice and be glad in it. He brought us from mourning to dancing, from glory to glory. This is the day the Lord has made. So what are we waiting for? La 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 la. Come on and praise the Lord. La 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 la. Hear the word of the Lord. There's freedom for the captives. Good news to the poor. And beauty for the ashes. So what are we waiting for? What are we waiting for? This is the day the Lord has made. Oh, I will rejoice and be glad in it. This is the day the Lord has made. Oh, I will rejoice and be glad in it. He brought us from morning to dancing, from glory to glory. This is the day the Lord has made. So what are we waiting for? La 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 la. Come on and praise the Lord. La 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 la. I live to tell what the Lord has done. I live to sing of my Savior's love. I live because He is risen. La 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 la. I live to tell what the Lord has done. I live to sing of my Savior's love. I live because He is risen. I live to tell what the Lord has done. Oh, I will rejoice and be glad in it. This is the day. This is the day the Lord has made. Oh, I will rejoice and be glad in it. This is the day the Lord has made. Whoa, I will rejoice and be glad in it. He brought us from morning to dancing, from glory to glory. From morning to dancing, from glory to glory. From morning to dancing, from glory to glory. This is the day the Lord has made. So what are we waiting for? La 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 la. Come on and praise the Lord.
Spirit, breathe. stone was moved for good, for the Lamb had conquered death, and the dead rose from their tombs, and the angels shouted it all, for the souls of all who come to the Father are restored, and the church of Christ was born, and the Spirit lit the flame. Now these gospels through the
hallelujah. Don't you gaze down on me, lift up your song. Cause you got a lion inside of those lungs. Get up and praise the Lord. Come on, my soul. Oh, don't you gaze down on me, lift up your song.
Sing that.
Your cross is my freedom. Your stripes are my healing. All praise, King Jesus. Glory to God in heaven. Your blood still speaking. Your love still reaching. All praise, King Jesus. Glory to God forever.
Glory to God in heaven. is a God who leads. Oh, praise the one who would reach for me. Sing hallelujah to the Son of suffering. Oh, blood and tears. Oh, blood and tears. How can it be that there's a God who is? There's a God who leads. Oh, praise the one who would reach for me. Sing hallelujah to the Son of suffering. Hallelujah.
Thank you so much for the ability to worship you here today. God, we thank you, Lord, that you took upon our sufferings on that cross, Lord. God, that you saw us, Lord. You saw our deep sin on this world, God. And you knew because you are perfect and because you are holy in heaven forever that sin leads to death. And if we were to have eternal life, you cannot be with sin. But because you saw our sin, Lord, and had your love and compassion and mercy on us, you came down as a man and died on that cross for us, taking our sin for us. You became sin who knew no sin, that we would become the righteousness of God. And by your grace alone, through repentance and faith in you, Jesus, we could stand before you on judgment day as if Christ, who is the perfect Lamb of God, is standing in our place. Hallelujah. Thank you to this Son of Suffering, Jesus Christ. You deserve the glory. You deserve the praise forever and ever. We lean on you, Lord. We love you, Lord. God be praised. Glory to Jesus. In the name of Jesus we pray. Amen.
Thank you, worship team. Isn't it great? What is heaven going to be like? Thank you for leading us into the presence of God and preparing the way for our hearts to be open, our eyes and minds to be open to God's word. Amen? Well, our middle schoolers and our high schoolers are released to go to your class and learn well, guys. and gals, learn well. This is our future. This is who's going to be standing up here, preaching, singing. Amen, amen. As we prepare to receive our tithes and offering, our ushers will prepare. We just want to mention that today is our last day that you could pick up this beautiful blue bag that says Rahway Food for Friends. And we've partnered with Rahway Food for Friends Food Bank twice a year. And we have a lot of blue bags there. Not many left last week. So please, take your nice blue bag. Inside the bag is a list of things to bring. And we want to bless them in the Thanksgiving season so that they can feed many people. Amen? There's a lot of homeless out there. There's a lot of underprivileged, unfortunate, that just are not going to spend the holiday like we're going to spend the holiday. That's why we really always have to be thankful. So please, take a bag, take a couple of them. Give them to your family, your friends. There's a lot back there, but they have to be returned next week because that week we bring them to Rahway Food for Friends. Amen? So we're going to worship the Lord through the receiving of our tithes and offering, and this is worship as well. The way we just worshiped in song and spirit, we worship in giving back to God a portion that he deserves, that he requires of us so that we could do the ministry, so that we could bless others in and around our community, in and around the world, and that's what we do. So thank you for partnering with us and being faithful in your giving. So let's pray. Father, we thank you that once again we can show our worship to you in our giving, in our receiving of our tithes and offering. We thank you for your blessing to us, Father, all that you've given to us, and we give now just that small portion back to you, and we know you'll do what you did with the loaves and the fishes. You'll do it here. So we thank you for it. Thank you for all those that are faithful to this ministry and giving faithfully each week. We give you the glory for that and the honor in the name of Jesus. Amen. Let's just check out what's happening in our FYI.
Welcome to The Journey. Hey, Oasis, my name is Nikki. I'm a leader in Celebrate Recovery. We prayed and we thought about it, and we changed the name of Celebrate Recovery to The Journey. When I first got into recovery, I thought everybody needed Jesus. When I came to the church, I thought everybody needed 12 steps. So if you have a hurt, habit, and hang up that you're recovering from, we're all recovering from something, come join us on The Journey.
Welcome to Oasis Christian Center. If you're watching online, thank you for joining us. Thank you all for your faithfulness and giving. It helps us make a difference around the corner and around the world. The best way to give is online by visiting oasisnj.net and clicking the Give button. Don't forget to follow us on all our social media platforms at OCCNJ. Also, don't forget to visit us at oasisnj.net for all upcoming events.
If today is your first time visiting us at Oasis Christian Center, please take a few moments to fill out this Connect card, which is located in the back of your seats. You can drop it off right here at our information table, which is located in the blue room in our foyer. We will have somebody waiting for you with a nice welcome gift.
Oasis is a place for you to know God, find hope, and make a difference. Thank you for joining us and enjoy the rest of the service.
Well, hey, good morning. How are you guys doing today? It is good to see you guys. I was on my third sabbatical this year. No, I'm just joking. Some of you probably thought, where is he at now? I had COVID, and I felt so bad I had to bail out of the water baptism, but I figure in the name of the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit, and a little bit of COVID probably wouldn't be the best way to be baptizing people. Amen? So it's taken a little bit to get over it. I'm still kind of dealing with some. I'm negative as of last Sunday. Hallelujah. It was not too bad, but it just left me definitely fatigued, congested. My voice attacked my voice. But you guys are first service, so we'll get through it. I don't know what happened second service, but we got the first one covered. Amen. It's good. So, I just want to do one thing. Of course, this weekend is we honor. Thank you. It's good to see you too, my friend. It's Veterans Weekend, and as it was yesterday, so we're celebrating that this week. And I want to say, if you are a veteran, Pastor Peter, you didn't do this, right? I think I was doing it, okay. For those of you that are veterans, would you do me a favor? Would you stand? Because we want to honor you today and thank you for your service to this country. Thank you so much. Thank you. The sacrifice that you give of your time and what you sowed into this country, the freedoms that we have, we do not take those freedoms lightly. As Americans, as anybody, we should never take our freedoms lightly. There's always a cost. See, there's nothing for free, okay? We call it freedom, but that freedom didn't come free. It came with a cost. And there are men and women that have helped our country have that freedom. And what we have today is I've traveled, and nothing against our guests today. We have Pastor Nala and his wife Ika here this morning. Just to say a quick hi to you guys, I am going to speak. But, you know, I've been to a lot of different places and mission fields and things. And we have a blessed country. And we sometimes take our freedoms for granted. It's not perfect by no stretch of the imagination. There's no country that's perfect. But we live in a blessed nation, and we need to be grateful for that. And thank you for the men and women here and those of you watching that you've served our country. We thank you. We applaud you. We appreciate you. Thank you. I also want to take an opportunity, as I mentioned, Pastor Nala, you've heard me talk about it. He was here last year. You were here, right? And so they were. He and his wife, Ika, were in a meeting this week in Oklahoma City. Ika, this is her first time in the United States, so she got to see Oklahoma, and that's not really a good picture of the United States. Oklahoma's okay. Nothing wrong with Oklahoma, but it's just the reality of, you know, come to New York City with lots and lots of people and stuff. So, you know, she had a great introduction. I'm going to ask them to come up and say a quick greeting this morning, and just welcome them as they probably came the longest to be here this morning.
National leader of IPHC for our country, Indonesia. So since 6th of November until 9, we have a Global Leadership Summit in Oklahoma. And then we've been thinking, since we are in the U.S., I'm going to visit my friend's church, Pastor...
It's an honor to have Fred, you. Thank you.
Pastor Fred. Yeah, and then to meet all of you. So the reason why we flew from Oklahoma to Utah and to here, and we just arrived.
They just got here at 5:30 this morning, so they have not slept, so, yeah.
Because we would like to say thank you very much for all of you, for all your sacrificial giving. Then this giving is enabled us to build an orphanage in the eastern part of Indonesia, in Papua. Because of your giving, we have an orphanage that they don't have to rent every year. Now they have their property run by a lady. Her name is Pastor Maria. So on behalf of our church, we would like to say thank you so very much. Although you cannot come to Indonesia, but your offering already received, and then we pray that and we believe that through your offering, the name of our Lord Jesus be glorified, and many more people can come to our Lord Jesus Christ. I think that's the short greetings I want to say to you. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. I really appreciate them taking the time to come out. It was a long journey. Next time, let me book your flights, though, okay? Because I looked at him, I was like, you're leaving Oklahoma, and you're going to Utah to visit for... how many hours? I don't know. And then flying to Newark. But next time, let me know. I'll take care of you, Banala. My second job should be a travel agent because I know how that works. But I'm so appreciative of them being here today. And just honestly, an amazing couple. I don't know if those of you may have got to talk to Pastor Banala last time. They are genuine and doing an amazing work as he's leading. How many churches are you over in Indonesia? 200. 200 churches that he oversees in Indonesia. So, you know, and this guy is such an incredible, humble man, just doing amazing work, and he has such a genuine heart for what he's doing. And I couldn't think of anybody more honored, the right person to be over 200 churches than a person like him and his wife, Ika, who it takes two. Right? They work together to be able to serve and to make a difference in that country. And it's not easy, but they're doing a great work. And so Anyways, as I mentioned, so I'm gonna get into the message today. I don't know how much time we have, but I'll take a little bit this morning, and I'm excited to be here this morning. Amen. And to be able to be, got the energy to move forward. And thank you guys for praying for me while I was out. But it's just good to be here. I missed you guys. And so anyways, I want to talk this morning about something that I think is, before I open up with that, let's just ask a question. How many like, I love nature, okay? I love sunsets and sunrises and, I think it is just looking at the beauty of creation. Of what God has done is just so amazing. I find, I've gotten up super early to take pictures of sunsets and sunrises and then sunsets, and I love driving through mountains and looking at the vistas of all of there and along the shore, and my brother lives in California, and some of the roads we've been able to drive along there and be able to just look at the ocean below and the cliffs. It's just an amazing, the beauty of God's creation and what He's done and what He's created. I'm just like that, and I think my kids are finally kind of getting it. A long time ago, they'd be like, "Really?" I'm like, "Look at that! Oh my gosh, that's so incredible!" And they're like, oh, "Okay," but I think they've got it now. They understand as they got older. But anyways, I love doing that, and also I was talking back on my sabbatical. I was with a group of a number of pastors, and so we were just talking about a number of different things and stuff that we've kind of seen or done or kind of like that. And they looked at me. One of the guys looked at me and goes, "You're like an adrenaline junkie, aren't you?" I said, "Well, I never really kind of thought of myself as an adrenaline junkie, but I guess I'm maybe a little bit, And I look back, and there's like a number of kind of crazy things that I've done over my life. And, one of them was... And this all connects, so I'm not just taking a road trip. It all does connect. One of them was Brittany was my daughter was like 2 years old at that time, and Leslie and I we took her to the circus. And so somehow or other, some of you know this story, but unbeknownst to me, she signed us up to be an opening act for Ringling Brothers and Barnley and Bailey Circus. Have no idea that we'd gone down the front. You kind of see the clowns and all the stuff at the circus and stuff. And so we were down there, and we had Brittany there, and she was like loving it all and looking at all the different things. And before you know it, these people are putting a harness on me, and I have no idea what the harness is for. They're like, "Step in this," and I'm like, "Why am I stepping in this?" Like, "Oh yeah, your wife, gonna sign you up. We're gonna do this opening act and all this kind of scenario and." The whole bit. And I'm like, okay. And then, of course, the legal team follows with the clipboard and sign here and then sign here and sign here. In other words, if you die, it's not our fault. If you get trampled, it's not our fault. If you just do something stupid, it's not our fault. It's all your fault. That's me. So I'm like signing up. And I'm like, "What are we doing?" She goes, "I don't know what we're doing, but it's kind of cool." And we left our daughter with the ringmaster. I'm like, she's standing over, Brittany's standing over with the ringmaster. And it was I can't remember the guy's name. He was one of the last ringmasters they had, a real famous guy, and just super nice guy. We got a chance to meet him and talk to him a little bit while we were preparing. And they're like, "What are you going to do?" And he's like, "Oh, I want you to, what we're going to do is we have these horses, and they have an opening act, and they bring out, 20 horses or whatever they bring out that run around the circus, the circle, the main ring." And I'm like, "Okay." And they're like, "And so what you're going to do, you're going to get on top of the horse. And then as the horses are running around, you're going to stand up on the back of the horse. And there's thousands of people watching you." Okay? At first, I was like, "Are you crazy?" And then I was like, "That's kind of cool, because I said, I've done some crazy things in my life, and I was like, "Okay, that's kind of cool. Let me do it." And like the horses are those big draft horses, I believe is what they are, the ones you can't just hop. Like they had to literally grab my butt and push me up on top because you couldn't reach the top of the back of the horse. And they get me up on top, and then if I stand up, if I fall off, what happens? Like, "We got you. You got a line. We got you. Don't worry about it." I don't like those famous last words. And so, anyways. So sure enough, and so my Leslie, my late wife, she was in front of me on the horse in front of me, and here I'm looking at him like, "Seriously, you? I never expected in a million years that she would be the one to want us to do this." And so, sure enough, we get on these horses, and there's Brittany over there watching her mom and dad, doesn't know if they're gonna live or die, have no idea what's gonna happen, with the ringmaster, and we're on top of the thing, and they're running around, and sure enough, it comes time to stand up, and I'm watching her. She gets up, and she actually stood on the back of the horse for a few minutes before she went flying off, of course, they did grab her. And then I'm like, okay, my turn. And I get up, and I made it up to like knees, and then I took off. But afterwards, I think, wow, that was such a cool thing. And then we had people in the audience that recognized us. They're like, you know, friends, from, you know, like from her school. And they're like, Leslie, Fred, oh my goodness, what are you doing? And a couple other expletive words that they said along the way there. But it was like, what are you doing? And I was like, I don't know. We just kind of went down to see the clowns, and there we are. But, you know, I like kind of stuff like that. But this is not story time, but this kind of ties into it. But about 10, 11 years ago, it was our daughter graduated from high school, and it was my mom's birthday, and we had decided that we had never really done a trip with my mom before like this, and we said, Mom, let's go. So she had a bunch of points for a hotel, and you know, in anywhere, and so we found out there was one in Maui, so we decided to do that. So we went to Maui for Brittany's graduation and for my mom's birthday. It was pretty cool. We had never been there before. It was just a beautiful place, and I'm an adventure person, as I said, so whenever I get somewhere, I'm not going to sit in behind the confines of a hotel and a wall. I want to get out and explore. So, of course, we're going to do that. So we're driving around. And so, you know, I knew that there's this one road that goes around the top of it, and you just drive, okay? So I was just driving. And so I had I didn't really look to see what the roads were. And all of a sudden, the road is going along, and the road goes into a one-lane road. And what I found out later was that there's one strip of land, it's about a 20-mile, it's referred to as the Death Highway. It's the Kahikili Highway in Maui. It's about 20 miles, one-lane road, rock face on one side of you, drop-off cliffs on the other side of you. And there's barely any guardrails anywhere. And it's a windy road, and traffic goes both ways, which means you have to find a place to be able to pull over and let someone go by. Now, of all the crazy stuff that I have done, and I'm not going to sit up here and talk about those kind of things, but that was the one thing that freaked me completely out. Okay, because I don't remember what the rental car we had, but it was kind of one that I wasn't used to it. I couldn't really see the corner because the way the car was configured from what I was used to. And I'm driving, and you know, you're on the road. It is a paved road, but literally there's a cliff there in Roxanne. They had some little wires every now and then around corners that would not hold a goat, you know. and so here we're going all this whole thing, and I remember having to pass people and all this stuff, and I was just like my hands were probably like peered into the steering wheel because I was like I was not scared, but I was so anxious and so, you know, like freaked out really from this whole thing. I'm not knowing how long it is because I never really researched. I didn't realize it was for 20 miles like this, just winding around, and you got great views of the ocean, but, you know, make a left turn and you're going to really find the ocean, you know, way down there. So what really was the issue was because there was no guardrails. See, if you put some guardrails up there, there's something about a guardrail that lets you know that, okay, there's a safe zone between you and what's on the other side, the cliff that's on the other side. Like I said, in the guardrail they had, I remember I did stop at one point and took a picture. I couldn't find it. I was trying to find it. I took a picture of this like rusty wire with these little metal stakes that was around this one bend that just went straight down. And I was like, they just did it. Why don't they have guardrails here? And there's something about guardrails, when you think about it, that they give you this sense of protection. You know where the boundaries are. See, guardrails are set a few feet away from the danger zone. And as long as you don't plow through it, you're good. And so it gives this comfort. It gives this space of knowing I can go this far and I know I'm okay, but I need to be aware of it. It gives me the sense that there's danger on the other side. I need to watch this. I need to do it. So when you have a guardrail on the edge of where you are, you know that on this side, you're good. Over here, if you proceed in that direction, you're going straight over. Yeah, I made this yesterday. This is my little craft project. And like, thank you, God, for Home Depot. Okay. So if it looks really bad, don't tell me about it, okay? Because you'll hurt my feelings. So anyways, thank you very much. I appreciate that. Think about a guardrail, too. They help to direct you and to protect you. Kind of helps deflect back it. It shows you where to go and where not to go. They're designed to keep vehicles from straying into dangerous areas or off limits. And
But just as we understand what a guardrail can do to help define the areas of danger, to help direct and protect you, just as we understand that, there are biblical truths and wisdom that we must put into our life. Listen, you can drive down roads with guardrails and you can drive down roads without guardrails. And there's the protection in dangerous areas to have these. I mean, I remember I grew up in, when I was younger, in South Carolina near the Blue Ridge Mountains is where we lived, and we would take my great-grandmother up there just about every Sunday. We'd try to take her up and we'd drive in the mountains, and you know, there was the same thing. There was these sheer drops on the side that had no guardrails. And I remember I'd be in the back seat with her, and every time she'd get to one of those, she'd jump to the other side of the car and put me on the other side. I was like, here's my great-grandma, put me on the side that's going to go over. But honey, but grandma, we're all going, if we go over, we're all going over. It doesn't make any difference where you're sitting. But she didn't want to see it because she could only just see straight down. And so, but when we think about our life, though, not just the physical things of guardrails, but what is the benefit of, in our own life, of how we make these decisions? See, when we talk about a guardrail and using the idea of that, it's a personal decision of something that you place in your life that reminds you that this is as far as I go. I'm not going to proceed behind it because I understand if I go past this, what's on the other side is not going to help me. It's not going to help me in my spiritual life. It's not going to help me in my physical life. And so, you know, there's, when you look at this in scripture, there's so many scriptures that talk about this. Let me just give you two, and then we'll kind of lay the foundation. We're going to pick it back up next week. But in Proverbs chapter 4, verse 23, it says this: above all else, guard your heart, for everything you do flows from it. This verse tells us and emphasizes the importance of putting guardrails around our heart, to guard our heart. In other words, I will not allow this to lodge in my life. I'm not going to let fear lodge in my life. I'm not going to let unbelief lodge into my heart. I'm not going to let this situation or that situation. I refuse to allow that to get sunk into my heart because I will guard my heart. I put a guardrail up in my heart that anything that starts to come, when I see that something's trying to come into it, I'm gonna stand strong. I will refuse to not go any further with that. I'm not going to entertain the fear. I'm not going to entertain the lie. I'm not going to entertain the whatever it may be that's trying to enter into my heart to try to take me off the direction of what God is doing in my life. So it's like a guardrail that we see driving down the highway that keeps you in the direction, protects you, but keeps you going in the direction that you need to go. Fear comes in. Fear is one of those things that just tries to consume our life. You give it an inch and it takes a mile. I mean, it's one of those things that is incredible how that if I just allow fear to seep into my mind and into my heart and not understand that there's a guardrail there, I'm not allowing it in my life. I'm not going to go there with it. I'm not going to entertain it. But I'm going to go and pick up some of the songs that we were singing earlier about who Christ is, knowing who he is in my life, what he's done for me in my life, that I'm not going to allow that into my life. That I'm putting a barrier that says, I will not go there. I won't entertain it. I won't give it the opportunity in my life. And so it's understanding to draw those lines. And so that verse recognizes that the condition of our heart is significantly influenced by our actions and our decisions. So if my heart is significantly affected or influenced by my actions and my decisions, I need to know where the danger zone begins. And not go there. Now, this can apply to so many areas of our life, you know, from our relationships, our spiritual walk, of course, but in our relationships, your finances. I mean, if you don't have a barrier to know when to stop spending, you're going overboard. And trust me, I'm sure that most of us have done it, me included. Okay? Finances. Pastor, don't talk like that because we know Black Friday's coming up and I have a lot of things I want to buy because Amazon's going to be crazy with all kind of deals and, you know, and I'm not going to be looking at that. But maybe that's why you need to grab a hole and put a barricade up there, a guardrail in your life and say, okay, I'm setting the limit and I'm not going to go past that limit. Thus saith Pastor Fred and God. Amen. Galatians chapter 5 verse 22 says this: but the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, forbearance, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Against such things, there is no law. So what does that have to do? Well, the fruit of the Spirit can be seen as guardrails that are guiding us in our interactions and in our decisions, helping us to walk in the nature of Christ, the character of Christ. When I understand, when I look up and I have a guardrail such as, okay, that the fruit of my life, in other words, what is fruit? Fruit is the evidence of what's on the inside of me. If Jesus is in me, there should be evidence in my life. And so this little passage in Galatians here that we see gives us a picture of the character of Jesus, who he is, and the reflection that should be of Christ in us. And so for me, so what happens is that we have a guardrail that says that our life is to be reflecting love and joy and peace, forbearance, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. If those things are not there, so when I see myself going in a direction that, and this says, wait, we're supposed to walk in love. Because I've set a standard to saying that I will walk in, the fruits of the Spirit will be productive in my life. And if I start to see, if I don't have a line on how I'm going to handle, how I'm going to love people, how I'm going to forgive people, how I'm going to do it, if I don't have a barrier that says, wait, this is what we're doing, I refuse to go beyond that. In other words, I refuse to take this away and just love some people and not love a lot of others. But I make a decision to do this. And so I put that barrier in my life, that guardrail, that type of keeping, protecting me, directing me, keeping me in line in the direction I need to go. So let's just dive a little bit deeper. We'll pick back up next week. But in Ephesians, Paul is talking to the Christians at the church of Ephesus. And he starts off in chapter 5. He's talking about being imitators of God, walking in love, things to stay away from, about how to things to be aware of. And then he goes and he gives direction on how not, basically, in my word, not to wreck your life. There's a lot of things he says in this whole chapter, but it really kind of touches on a lot of different areas of our life. And so in Ephesians chapter 5, verse 15, we'll pick it up from there. And he says, he starts off, he says, be very careful then how you live. Be very careful how you live. And you know, sometimes we can read scriptures and we just kind of go past it. We don't take the moment to pause and really look at what he's saying. He's giving advice for them on how to live their life. They're not living in an easy environment. They're not living in a place, in a zone where, you know, it's like, you know, it's easy to be a Christian. I mean, they're the opposite. I mean, in a sense of, in a world that is dominated by, you know, worshiping idols and different gods and all these different things like that. And here you're talking about Jesus, and which was referred to, the Jesus movement then was called the Way. And it's like when you're looking at all that, and so here they are, and there's so many things that we see, different persecution and that happened throughout the church, the early church and things. And so here he is. He's saying, listen, guys, you're living in a time that's not going to be easy. It's not easy. He says, so you have to be careful how you live. The English Standard Version uses the word, look carefully then how you walk. Pay attention to how you walk. Have you been to a place where the ground was unstable, or maybe it was a sidewalk that was broken, or different things like that? And so you're walking along, and you have to literally be careful where you walk, how you walk, right? Because if you don't, you could twist your ankle, you could trip, you could fall. You know, if you're walking in you know, out on a farm, you have to, you know, my one of my cousins had a farm in Canada, and a huge farms in that he had. And you know, when we go out there to visit them and go walking out in the field, even as teenagers, I mean, we would go out there, and even younger, we'd go play out in the fields and stuff like that. And you had to watch, because when it's a cow field, there's these things called cow patties. And we're not talking little wafers, we're talking cow explosions, okay? And all it takes is one time stepping in one of those little things, and your entire foot covered with, let's just leave it there, you get the idea. You want to just leave it there. Lunch is coming soon, we won't mess you up. But you want to be careful where you walk and how you walk. And so Paul is saying, you know, in the times that you're living in, you have to be careful how you live, how you walk, how you do life. Because you can't just be flippantly floating through it. You need to be attentive. You need to watch what you're doing. He says, not as unwise, but as wise. As wise. In other words, what is the wise choice? See, it's not just making the right choice or the wrong choice, but what is the wise choice? I think when we look at it more as being what's the wise choice, it gives us a little bit different perspective of just a right, wrong thing. Yes, I understand the right and wrong, but when we look at it, okay, that I'm thinking, I'm putting a barrier in my mind that as I'm living life, as I'm doing this, that I'm going to do it to live wise, think wise. I'm going to live and walk carefully, and I'm going to think wisely in the decisions and the choices that I make. I mean, I'm sure I've done it. I'm sure maybe some of you have done it, made a split-second decision that you thought was okay, you thought was the right choice, but you never really thought was it the wise choice to make at the wise time to make it. And man, you really regretted every second of it. I've been there. And so it's this point of saying, see, not as unwise, but as wise. In other words, what's the wise choice? See, that gives a better thought to how I'm doing life. And he goes on to say in verse 15, 16, making the most of every opportunity. And see, when we make wise choices, we're making wise decisions, we are making the most of every opportunity. I'm not just flippantly going through life. I'm not just kind of floating la-la all through life, but I really am being attentive to what we're doing. And I'm kind of one of those people that I'm pretty observant. You know, I can kind of walk into a room when I walk out. I don't have a photographic memory, but I know if you've been messing with my stuff when I come back. I just kind of know where I leave things and the way that I leave things. And, you know, and I do kind of take an assessment of where I am. I usually find myself, when I sit in the way, and I didn't even realize I was doing it, but where I'm watching the room. I'm looking at what's around me. I'm not just, here I am. No, I'm there, but I'm also attentive of what is happening in that room, that who's coming in the room and who's going out of the room and those kind of things. And it's just a kind of thing, how I'm wired, I guess. But when I look at it, I think sometimes we just kind of, if we don't understand, we don't make a choice and decision to live wisely, to make it a point to walk wisely, then what happens is we miss the opportunities that God has for our life. He says, making the most of every opportunity. If I'm making wise decisions, I'm going to be aware of the opportunities, the doors that God opens up. You see, there's times that we're praying, God, open the door. God, help me in this thing. And he's got the door wide open. The light is shining through. The angels are like, ah, you know, everything is there. And we're like, wow, God, help me. How are you going to do this? We're totally missing it because we're not paying attention to how we're living and what he's doing in our life. Does that make sense? To live with a place of making the most of every opportunity. The English Standard Version says it this way, making the best use of the time. I like that. I'm very time focused. That's a part of what I had to learn. It took me, you know, talking about my sabbatical over the summer, it took me over a month. I think I may have said this one time already, but over a month to finally get to the point that I wasn't waking up on Sundays or Saturdays and Sundays in a panic that I didn't have the message done for Sunday. Because I went the extreme, and there's a balance in it. I was so extreme that literally in my timing, I was just like, you know, I would tell the kids, okay, like, you know, we're leaving in 6.5 minutes. You think I was in like military. I was never in the military, but I was wired pretty good for the time aspect of it. You know, just like knowing we got this, we got this, we got this, we got to do this. But there's a place in our life that we live in a way that we're attentive to what God is doing, for him to be able to see what he's doing in our life. Anyways, be careful with your time. And I think one of the things that is so important to understand is because you really have less time than you think you have. I don't mean that in a dark and like mournful kind of way. Like, oh no, you know, that means something's gonna happen tomorrow. No, the reality is we don't know what tomorrow holds. I never expected the day that, you know, we were getting ready for service here. My dad was when he was pastoring, you know, here, I wasn't expecting that, you know, he was just running a little bit behind, and I didn't expect that he'd have a massive heart attack while the first service was taking place and die in front of me in their house. At 50 years old, wasn't expecting that. But I can take it the other way too, is that sometimes because we don't take attentive of the time that we have, we waste time and opportunity to do the things that we can do to, in the relationships in our life. You know, it's like, oh yeah, next, you know, we'll, you know, if you're trying to build your relationship, oh yeah, next month we'll do this or this we'll do. And you don't, you never stop to take the time to say, you know, no, you know, we're going to have a date night and it's going to be on this date. We're putting it on the calendar. I don't care, as my mom would say, hell or high water, you know, and she didn't mean that in a negative kind of way, but come hell or high water, we're doing this, okay? Because you need to invest in your marriage, because you may not have next week to do that. Doesn't mean you're gonna die, I'm just saying you get busy with something else. But we allow other things to come in our life. And so we put up a guardrail that says, no, this is what we're going to do. Because we value this relationship so much that we will put a barrier that says, no, we're not gonna just be non-observant, but we are going to invest into this marriage. We're going to invest into this time. And people, I've said that people, oh, yeah, I don't want to have any money. We can't afford this. Listen, Leslie and I, we would do that. And like, we had nothing. We were in debt. We didn't have any money. So we would go to the mall. We'd leave all of our credit cards, literally all of our credit cards at home and money. So we couldn't buy anything. And we were living in Woodbridge. So we were like 5 minutes from Woodbridge Center. And we just would walk around and look, and you know, maybe we would have enough to buy something small, and we'd just sit there. Just, it was the time together to invest into our marriage, into our time together. Because there's so much pulling you away from each other. Amen? You guys with me? Okay. So he says, making the most of every opportunity. And so be careful how you live. Be attentive to your time, because the distractions around you can take you off course. And to pay attention to not only what you are doing, but also, because he says this to me, he says, because of the day, he's talking about him making most of every opportunity, he said, because the days are evil. It's not just paying attention to you, but it's also paying attention to what's going on around you. The distractions that Satan would try to use, the interference that he would try to bring into your life. Verse 17 says, therefore, do not be foolish, but understanding what the Lord's will is. In other words, you know where you are, you know, you know when you're stepping over a guardrail. You're attentive. You understand that I put this barrier, we're not gonna go in this direction in my life or in our marriage or in our situation. And so I'm gonna make it a point that I'm not gonna be foolish, but I'm gonna understand what God's will is in my life, what his word says in my life. I'm not gonna ignore what his word says. If God says, hey, this is what I have for you, this is what I want to do in your life, just as he said, just follow this, and in your life you're ever gonna have problems, but you're gonna have his will, you're gonna have his purpose, he's gonna have his life flowing in your life. And we ignore it, we miss the opportunity, then what happens is we find ourselves in a horrible place. Anyways, guardrails are the one thing that keeps us from another thing. It's the thing that we understand that this guardrail keeps it like this. When I was driving, if I had a guardrail, you know, going around, if you're driving, you got a guardrail going around a tight curve, that guardrail keeps you from going off of the cliff or the side or the danger, what's on this side. We begin to look in our life, and I'm just kind of laying the foundation a lot today. So next week we'll get into a little bit more detail with some stuff, but I want to challenge you to look at your life. What are some areas that you need to put some guardrails in for your spiritual walk? For your relationships, for your marriage, for your spiritual growth time, for the things in your life that we involved in, where are the lines we're putting? So Paul, he goes on here and he gives an example. So I'll dive into this real quick. We have a few minutes and he kind of gives an example within this, and he says this in verse 18 on how to walk in wisdom. He says, "Do not get drunk on wine." I think, what does that got to do with that? Where'd that come from all of a sudden? So we kind of look at it, and some scholars look at it as the fact that, you know, he's giving an example. He's talking about walking in wisdom. He's talking about making most of the opportunity. He says, do not get drunk on wine. Now, let's just look at a little of the historical aspect of this. In the ancient world, water was not necessarily something that was always accessible, nor was it also beneficial to you, because unless it was like water that had been flowing water, or that water that wasn't sitting around in some contamination, is like you can drink the water and you can die from it. And we don't think about that. We just turn on the faucet, pick it up, and drink it. But back then, so the majority of people, what they would drink would be wine. It's very common throughout the Middle Ages and through the time of Jesus. You look it up, you can find it yourself, because the simple fact was that if you didn't know the water was good or safe and you drank it, you're going to get dysentery. You could die from that water. Where the wine, that's not the case. And so He says, don't get drunk on wine. And so without a guardrail, now he's saying, now if you look at it from the aspect that the wine was like a common thing that they would drink because you couldn't always drink the water. And he says, don't get drunk on wine. What he's saying, drunk is the guardrail. You're going to have to drink this, but don't get drunk from drinking this. Does that make sense? Okay. So he's defining. So he's giving an example. So you're talking about how do you do opportunity, how do you live your life wisdom, that you put a guardrail within that. Without guardrails, one thing leads to another without resistance. In other words, do not get drunk, dot, 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 which leads to dot, dot, dot. Now, I never grew up with alcohol. I'm not a person that I don't drink. It was just never, it was in our household. We didn't do that. I grew up that way. In fact, back then, if you drank it, you went to hell. It was kind of like one of those kind of things. That was my background, okay? Some of you are like, yeah, and Pastor, can't believe you talk about it right now. Well, I didn't write this. I'm just reading what he wrote here. Now, I'm not saying you're going to hell. That's not what I'm saying. But I mean, that was the strict background that I grew up in. And so I never had it, and it's funny because if I'm ever in a place where people are drinking and they don't know me or whatever, really, they're like, "Oh, you don't drink? What's wrong? You anti?" And I'm like, "Oh, I'm just drinking water because I want water." Okay, back off. In my head, I'm saying that. I didn't say that out loud. Okay, but what he's doing is that the guardrail here is the drunk part, in the example that Paul is giving them. So remembering, a guardrail is a personal decision of something that you place in your life that reminds you, I'm not going there. Because danger is on the other side. And so he says, do not get drunk on wine, which leads to debauchery. What is debauchery? It's an indulgence in self-control. It's out of control, okay? In other words, I'm indulging myself and I have no self-control on what I'm doing. Whether I'm just eating. Like literally in the ancient world, that they would actually, if you go into Rome and see the Colosseum, there's actually rooms that are along there that were, I'm trying to think what they called them. And I knew the name this morning. I can't remember. But I remember going there and I saw it and they're like, yeah, that's where they would go and eat. Because if you were wealthy then and you wanted to let everybody see you're wealthy, you would just gorge and eat. And then you go to, it's like a barfatorium or something like that. And literally you would go to this room and you would throw up everything that you just eat so that you could go back out there and eat because you're so rich, you want everybody to see how rich you are on how much food that you can consume. And they would just eat it and throw it up. Wasting, but saying, wow, I'm so rich, look at me. That's debauchery. And it can be sexual, it can be food, it can be anything that you can have. This self-indulgence, just no barriers, no guardrails, just give me, I want it all and I'm going to do it all. There's nothing that says, don't go here. And Paul says, for the example of wine, you're drinking it because you can't necessarily drink the water. He says, but the guardrail is you drink it, but you don't get drunk because the drunkenness always leads to something that you can't control. I mean, there's been a lot of mistakes happen because of people who have been drunk. We're not going down that this morning, so you can just, okay, thank God, we're not doing that. But you I'm not even going to say you did that. It's like when we look at it and see that he's saying this is the line. So what he says, do not get drunk on wine that leads to debauchery. Instead, be filled with the Spirit. When you accepted Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior of your life, the Holy Spirit came to reside in you. Have you noticed that, especially if you're a new believer, that it changes the way you think? It's not always, boof, all of a sudden it's different, but there's that still small voice. There's that like, you really want to do that? It's the pause. Do you know what I'm saying? It's kind of this, that when you give in and you're saying, God, I'm surrendering my life to you, and even if you don't even know it, it's like when the Holy Spirit is that comes in and takes and fills your life as a new believer, it's that pause that lets you think, this doesn't feel right. You know what I'm talking about? It's not this in-your-face screaming at you, but it's that little voice that says, wait, should we put a barrier? Should we put a guardrail up here and not come back to this spot again? Is this really what you want in your life? So why don't we put something that says, I'm not going there again? The The Holy Spirit gives us that, the understanding that instead of the full force flying over the cliff, that moment of pause. See, that can be in every area of our life, our spiritual walk, our relationships, our finances, life in general, your work, whatever you do. Where in your life do you need to set a guardrail? Where in your life do you need to put a line that says, I'm not going there anymore? Something that when you get to the point, it's like, oh, nope, that's the guardrail, I'm backing off. A point where you turn away and you ask the Holy Spirit to lead you in a different direction. 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 12, as we close, says, so if you think you're standing firm, be careful that you don't fall. What is that saying? Sometimes we think we're all, I've got this, I'm good. And we have no guardrails. We have nothing that says, don't go here. This is destructive. If you cross this line, it's going to destroy your marriage. If you cross this line, it's going to destroy your spiritual life. If you cross this line, it's going to mess up a whole bunch of things in your life. So he says, when you think you're standing firm, be careful that you don't fall. Because you're a little overconfident. Maybe a little prideful. We need to remind ourselves of the potential of stumbling and falling and make it a point that we establish spiritual guardrails in our life that stand there. And we get to the point we see it like, oh, wait, I want to be on this side because I know what's on the other side of that. And I don't want that. But see, when we take it away, the temptation of it is just like, wow, come a little closer, come a little closer. I don't know if you've ever done that. I'm not that much of an adrenaline junkie that I'll actually stand on the end of a ledge, but I don't know. It's like whenever, if you've ever walked up to a ledge, maybe it's just me, but I've heard other people talk about it. There's just something always makes you feel to pull you over. You know what I'm talking about? Some of you have no idea what I'm talking about. Some of you do. It's the weirdest feeling, you know. And there's times I wanted to look down and I'm over, and it's just like all of a sudden you just feel like this thing is pulling you. And you just want to go and resist back because I am not stepping over that. When we don't have a guardrail, there's so much that pulls us in the direction that is destructive in our life. So this week, your homework is go to Home Depot, buy a guardrail, carry it with you in your backpack. Yes, exactly. Is to really look at those things in our life to say, okay, where... See, I think we all know where we need a guardrail. Listen, if you've kind of stepped off a cliff in something, you know you need to put a guardrail there. And we don't go back there again. Next, we're going to pick this up and go a little bit further than this. But Father, I just thank you for the opportunity today. My prayer is that this week that the Holy Spirit will just give us a discerning and understanding of the areas in our life that Satan just loved to destroy. And that we're not going to give him the opportunity to do that. That we will put a scripture, we'll put a spiritual guardrail in our life. That we make this decision that says, I will not go there. That's the line. And I refuse to cross. And Father, we just ask that as we make those decisions, that you just give us the wisdom, the strength of the Holy Spirit that gives us the power to stand against all the lies and all the attacks of the enemy that would try to derail our relationships and our lives and making decisions that are just destructive within our life. Father, help us be able to be wise in all those things as we put those things in order. We put those spiritual guardrails in our life that'll draw the line. To know that your direction, the Holy Spirit leading us, gives us the strength to do just that in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, hey, it's good to see you guys. If you need prayer, our team will be up front. Pastor Nala and Ika is here if you want to say hi to them real quick. I'm going to try to conserve my voice for the next service, but love you guys. It's so good to see you. Have an amazing week. Also want to say on your way out, if you did not pick up one of these, pick up one, and it's going to be a big help to our city. And as Pastor Peter said, so those are in the back. Don't forget to grab those on your way out if you would. Thank you.